Fresh meat. How could a 20-year-old filmmaker so skillfully overcome such a notoriously doomed production, full of demoralizing logistical nightmares, incessant technical difficulties, squalid conditions, and countless injurious hurdles en route to crafting one of the scariest and most beloved cult horror movies of all time? Awaken the Deadites and find out what the f*** happened to this horror movie. Before we delve into the particulars, here's a plotline refresher for the shamefully uninitiated. The Evil Dead follows a gullible quintet of Michigan college students who venture to a secluded cabin in the woods for a little R&R. Upon discovering a recording of evil incantations in the basement and an accursed text titled the Necronomicon, aka the Book of the Dead, four of the five students are possessed by a deadly demonic ghoul. All four bloodthirsty former friends proceed to attack the fifth, Ash Williams, played by the legendary Bruce Campbell. Our campily cartoonish and kitschy kick-ass hero, who has since become synonymous with the entire Evil Dead franchise. Victimized by one refreshingly vicious salvo after another, Ash must put an end to the sinister scourge by fully dismembering each and every damned demon who dares cross his path. After meeting each other in high school in 1975, Michigan natives Sam Raimi and Bruce Campbell began making Super 8mm short films together, along with their mutual friend, Robert Tappert. In 1977, the trio worked on Raimi's feature film debut, It's Murder, a 70-minute, no-budget horror comedy about the mysterious killing of a family's uncle. While shooting one particular suspense sequence, Raimi got the notion to pursue a career in drive-in horror cinema. Shortly after, Raimi was inspired to film prototype sample footage that he could shop to investors as a proof of concept to raise enough money to make a full-length version of what would eventually become The Evil Dead. 1 year later, in 1978, Raimi, Campbell, and Tappert made a 32-minute short film entitled Within the Woods on a shoestring budget of $1,600. Upon showing it to investors, Raimi was able to raise $90,000 to immediately get started on a feature-length version of the yet-to-be-titled The Evil Dead. To secure the entire budget for the film, Raimi solicited funding from relatives, lawyers, dentists, and any other outside investor he thought might be interested in donating to the cause. While unable to reach the figure he sought, Raimi was still able to raise $375,000 to make an extended remake of Within the Woods. When the film ran out of money halfway through production, Raimi, Campbell, and Tappert borrowed funds from relatives, took out bank loans, and cold-called local businesses for sponsorship. With the budget in place, Raimi, Campbell, and Tappert began scouting locations to shoot the film, which at the time was called Book of the Dead. It was producer Irwin Shapiro who later convinced Raimi that the title sounded too boring and ought to be changed to The Evil Dead. Raimi wisely capitulated. With Tappert on board as producer and Campbell cast as protagonist Ash Williams, Raimi put out an open casting call using an ad in the Detroit News. The advert drew the attraction of local actors Betsy Baker, who was cast as Linda in the film, and Ellen Sandwise, who plays Cheryl, and had also appeared in Within the Woods. The other main actors subsequently cast include Richard DeManicor as Scott and Teresa Tilly as Shelley. As for the small, tight-knit crew, Raimi surrounded himself with close friends and family members, including brothers Ted and Ivan Raimi, actor and filmmaker Scott Spiegel, technician Josh Becker, special makeup effects artist Tom Sullivan, and transportation chief David Goodman. Many of these collaborators wore multiple hats on location and served in various production capacities. For example, Bruce Campbell also collateralized his parents' property in Michigan to ensure Raimi had enough money to complete the film and subsequently enlarged the print to 35mm. For this, Raimi credited Campbell as an executive producer. With a lack of experience across the board, Raimi and company began to seek a functional cabin in nearby Royal Oak, Michigan. When the state denied them access on the basis of an unsupportable script, Raimi and crew chose to film in Morristown, Tennessee, the only state in the country willing to accommodate the project. Little did Raimi know how unaccommodating the cabin was, and how unexpectedly freezing Tennessee would get late fall and early winter. When the production arrived on location, Raimi and company were subjected to hellish living conditions. The remote, genuinely abandoned cabin they found was completely disheveled and had zero insulation, electricity, or plumbing. The place was littered with horse manure and had to be completely renovated from front to back. During pre-production, as many as 13 crew members stayed in the cabin each night, often sleeping on the floor in the same room. As a result of the squalid conditions, tempers flared, Several arguments broke out, multiple people fell ill from freezing temperatures, and none of them could take showers during their two-month stay. Unfortunately, this was a harbinger of the chaos to come.
Why are you torturing me like this?
Principal photography on The Evil Dead officially commenced on November 14th, 1979. In his autobiography, If Chins Could Kill, Confessions of a B-Movie Actor, Bruce Campbell admitted that the entire Evil Dead shoot was a, quote, comedy of errors, and 12 weeks of mirthless exercise in agony. Indeed, the novice crew got lost in the woods on the very first night after shooting a scene on the bridge, and several of the actors suffered multiple injuries during filming. Since the cabin was remotely located, access to medical assistance was severely limited. One infamous on-set mishap involved actress Betsy Baker, whose eyelashes were torn off in one unfortunate swipe when removing her prosthetic face mask. Another major issue arose with the chintzy contact lenses that were used to give the character's eyes a demonic, milky white appearance. Due to the limited budget, cumbersome contacts as thick as glass were used on the actors, taking up to 10 minutes to apply per person. The contacts were so uncomfortable that they could only be worn for roughly 15 minutes at a time until an actor's eyes were depleted of air. The whole process was so burdensome that Campbell famously equated the equation to having Tupperware over his eyes. During the scene in which Linda accosts Ash and tries to stab him with a dagger, Baker literally could not see him and had no idea where she was, leaving Campbell to battle a blind performer on film. Campbell continued to receive the brunt of physical punishment during the shoot. At one point, he injured his ankle and leg after tripping on a root while running down a steep hill. Raimi used a stick he found in the woods to poke and prod Campbell's injury in the sadistic belief that if the actors experienced real pain, it would translate onto the screen in the most effective ways. Later, a cameraman tripped while filming a shot and slammed his camera into Campbell's face, knocking out several of his teeth. Yet another injury Campbell sustained actually made it into the final cut of the film. When the demonically possessed Cheryl's hand bursts through the floor and lunges at Ash, the off-screen puppeteer really gouged Campbell's head. The subsequent trickle of blood on Ash's face is 100% authentic. In addition to Campbell's physical agony, several other actors were stabbed, scraped, cut, bruised, and hurled into various objects while making the movie. Ellen Sandwise in particular recalls being brutally lacerated by tree branches while dashing through the woods without any sort of protective padding. Quote, exhaustion doesn't even describe. I was running in my nightgown. It was 40 or less degrees, Sandwise says. Quote, I was running through the woods, brambles. There were no pads or anything. Just running and running, nonstop, getting hurt. Speaking of Cheryl's infamous exterior troubles, we'd be remiss not to mention the deeply disturbing demonic tree rape she experiences within the woods. According to Sandwise, this sequence was not included in the original script and was only described on the page as Cheryl is attacked by the woods. However, the scene kept devolving into depravity as it was shot. The final image of the phallic branch savagely impaling Cheryl's nether regions was added in post-production, much to Sandwise's dismay. The harrowing scene is still banned in certain countries. In recent years, Raimi has publicly regretted including the scene in the film, and Campbell has also expressed remorse for physically slapping Linda multiple times in another scene. The original script also called for the characters to smoke weed while listening to the demonic recording in the basement. Aspiring for authenticity, the actors got stoned for real before filming the scene the first time, but their behavior was so erratic, the sequence had to be entirely reshot. As for the frigid temperatures, several crew members contracted viruses and other illnesses while filming. The weather became so unseasonably cold in Tennessee that camera equipment and cable wires literally froze, necessitating them to be thawed by the fireplace inside the cabin during off hours. By the end of the shoot in January 1980, conditions became so severe, all of the interior furniture in the cabin was burned on site to keep the cast and crew warm. Since only exterior shots were left to film by then, the furniture was deemed expendable. Yet for all the mishaps that occurred during the shoot, Raimi overcame each challenge by achieving one ingenious and viscerally terrifying set piece after another. From the onset, Raimi deliberately conceived of a fast-paced visual style defined by kinetic camera movement and off-kilter angled compositions. For the opening shot of the demonic POV rapidly hovering across the pond, Raimi had Campbell simply push him in a dinghy while the camera rolled. To achieve several of the unique-looking shots in the film, a multitude of makeshift camera rigs were custom built by Raimi and crew. Since production couldn't afford a dolly or a newfangled Steadicam, many of the subsequent dynamically fluid demon POV shots were done by mounting a camera to a 2x4 piece of wood, while Raimi and Campbell each held one side of the board and ran at full speed through the woods, jumping over logs, rocks, puddles, and shrubbery in the process. The Kinetic shaky cam result proved to be a respectable but cost-effective stand-in for the Steadicam. Another creative DIY rig included the VasoCam, which required a fixed camera to glide over a series of long wooden planks to achieve a dynamic visual fluidity. The scene in which Ash drives away from the cabin, gets out of the car, and appears to walk in a surreally canted angle was also achieved by a simple but effective practical effect. Raimi had Campbell park the car on an incline and tilted the camera ever so slightly to match the angle. When Ash exits the car, he is walking on flat ground, but the shot makes him appear as if he's ambling at a jaunty angle, creating a memorably freaky image. The final shot of the film was achieved by mounting the camera to a tripod and strapping it onto a motorcycle before rapidly driving through the cabin and crashing into Ash, to appear as one long, unbroken shot. According to Campbell, during the premiere of the TV spin-off series Ash vs. Evil Dead, he cracked a few ribs while filming the shot. Another notable practical effect used during filming included producer Robert Tappert smoking cigarettes off-screen, mere feet away from the camera, to create the illusion of dust appearing in the cabin. For the exorbitant amount of gore used in the film, gallons of fake blood was created using a combination of Karo syrup, red food coloring, and non-dairy creamer. For the milky white pus that emanates from the demons when they're punctured, Raimi opted to use 2% milk. As for the demons' zombified entrails seen when they melt at the end of the film, creamed corn was used. The sound of impaled flesh was achieved by recording chicken meat being stabbed. For the creepy howling wind sound effect, Raimi recorded the noise himself after waking up in the middle of the night to a similar sound in his Tennessee apartment during production. Upon hearing the menacing noise, Raimi grabbed his sound equipment and recorded several minutes of the whipping wind in the middle of the night. The result was so chilling that the sound effect was used in several other movies released after The Evil Dead, to Raimi's surprise. Additional DIY details while making the film include Campbell using an authentic chainsaw and shotgun in the film. In the scene where Ash lifts the chainsaw blade to his possessed girlfriend Linda's chest, a real chainsaw was used. A close-up of Linda's neck reveals her genuinely pounding pulse as the revving blade saws inches from her torso. Given the low budget, Campbell bought the inexpensive single-barrel shotgun at a local Kmart to use in the film. During the scene in which he blasts a deadite through the cabin window, Campbell really fired a live shotgun round into a dummy studded with fake blood packs to create maximum realism. When production wrapped, Campbell and Tappert purchased 100 shotgun rounds and blasted every prop on location to smithereens. Raimi then gathered the remains and used them as fuel to start a large bonfire, which may or may not have burned the cabin to the ground. Despite the long-held myth that a lightning strike caused the cabin to burn down, Raimi eventually admitted to doing it himself. Interestingly enough, once filming wrapped, the crew buried a time capsule full of personal mementos beneath the fireplace in the cabin. While the cabin burned down, the fireplace was the only thing left standing. Principal photography on The Evil Dead officially ended on January 23, 1980. Nearly every cast and crew member went home, leaving only Raimi and Campbell on location. After reviewing the footage they captured, Raimi realized a few pickup shots were needed to finish the movie, including a final scene where Ash is repulsively sprayed with monster guts. Because the cabin in Tennessee didn't have a cellar, the basement scenes in the film were shot in the cellar of a farmhouse owned by Tappert's family in Marshall, Michigan. When the characters first descend into the cellar, they really went into a shallow pit dug just below the entry hole. When the film cuts to inside the cellar, the footage shot in Raimi's garage is used. During reshoots, several crew members such as Ted and Ivan Raimi stand in for Ash and various other characters and are filmed from behind so as not to reveal their faces. Ardent Raimi acolytes know that these substitutes are dubbed fake Shemps, a reference from Raimi's fondness for the Three Stooges. Once filming was completed, Raimi sought local talent from the Detroit Editing Association. He hired Edna Paul to edit the film. Her assistant happened to be the pre-famous Joel Cohen. While Paul cut most of the movie, Cohen famously edited the hyperkinetic shed sequence. Raimi and both Joel and Ethan Coen became fast friends while working on the film, and would go on to collaborate on the 1985 comedy Crime Wave. Moreover, the Coens used Raimi's business model for making a prototype sample trailer to secure funding for their own feature film debut, Blood Simple, in 1984. The first assembled cut of The Evil Dead clocked in at 117 minutes, which Campbell claimed was quite a feat considering the script was only 65 pages or so. The film was subsequently whittled down to a more digestible 85 minutes by chopping all of the grim and depressing story beats and focusing on Ash's vengeful violence and his emotional grief over seeing his friends turn into grotesque, flesh-starved ghouls. Because many of the sounds were improperly recorded on location in Tennessee, they had to be re-recorded in the editing process, which included Campbell screaming into a microphone for hours on end. Once the editing process was completed, the 16mm footage was blown up to 35mm, and prints were prepared for exhibition. The movie enjoyed a grand premiere at the famed Redford Theater in Detroit, Michigan, on October 15, 1981. Afterward, Raimi continued to show the film to anyone willing to watch, eventually coming across horror film distributor Ivan Shapiro. The title was then officially changed to The Evil Dead and screened out of competition at the 1982 Cannes Film Festival, of which Shapiro was a co-founder. Horror icon Stephen King saw the movie and bestowed a glowing review. King's ringing endorsement launched The Evil Dead into a new stratosphere of success as the film continued to tour around the country and play on the international festival circuit. In 1982, New Line agreed to distribute the film in a wider capacity. It wasn't until April 15, 1983, that The Evil Dead was officially released theatrically in the United States, where it ultimately grossed roughly $2.4 million against its modest $375,000 budget. The movie became even more popular when it was released on home video in 1983, becoming the most rented movie of the year in the UK. Its cult status continued to skyrocket with home video VHS and DVD editions in the 1990s. However, due to Raimi's insistence on keeping the extreme gore and graphic carnage, the film was initially tagged with an X rating. As a result, the film's profile was raised when it was named a video nasty, a category of films in Europe deemed too violent and unsettling for public consumption, and listed as the number one nasty due to its high rental sales. While the video nasty tag led to the film's censorship, where it's still banned in certain countries to this day, the publicity also helped promote the movie and increase its status as an all-time horror cult favorite. Of course, as any serious horror fan knows, Raimi would go on to write and direct two equally loved sequels, Evil Dead 2 in 1987 and Army of Darkness in 1992, and produced a remake of the original in 2013. And three seasons of cable series Ash vs. Evil Dead. While the sequels were more comedically cartoonish, or slapstick, to use Raimi's term, all three Raimi films feature the zany directorial stylings that remain his personal filmmaking calling card. In an unfathomable trivia tidbit, Raimi had roughly 1,000 times the budget of The Evil Dead to make Spider-Man 3 in 2007, which at the time was the most expensive movie made to date. Bruce Campbell, meanwhile, endured the punishment of Raimi's hand to become a genre icon. And there you have it. Thanks to youthful enthusiasm, passion for cinema, and sheer ingenuity, a near-novice filmmaker and his friends defied overwhelming odds to create an unforgettable maelstrom of hyper-gory mayhem and a truly distinct visual style. Even after four decades, The Evil Dead maintains and deserves its place as one of the greatest horror experiences ever put to film.
To awake on the soaked streets of Blue Island. And my father, though a strong man, you know, I swear I saw him crying. Another generation gone has ceased South Sidon. We say a prayer and you put him.
Thank you for watching our show. If you like what you see, please subscribe to our Joe Blow Horror Videos channel. Tell your friends who like this sort of content and turn on the bell to receive notifications of all our latest videos. We're an independent company and we appreciate all of your support.